This evening, it may not be really the cross alone that I will be talking about. A message definitely given to the church of the latter day. We call ourselves the remnant. How is it pertinent to the church that we are claiming to be the remnant of God? Centric to all Christendom, centric to all Christian thought, centric to all Christian philosophy of life is the cross. You look in the pews, you look in the seats, you look in the place that you worship, cross is displayed. It has virtually become the identity of a Christian. Crosses decorate the churches, even the Seventh-day Adventist churches. You will find them on the books, in the pews. You will find them on the walls where you worship. The priests wear them on their garments. It has become a symbol of sacredness. A Christian activity is void if it doesn't have the cross somewhere displayed. Particularly at the time of Easter, you will see even in the Seventh-day Adventist churches, the crucifixion enacted. A live person carrying I have seen it first time some years ago in Silver Spring Church. I was horrified because the man was beaten, of course, in an action. The scene of crucifixion. It has virtually gotten a place in the Christian's life. It has also become a symbol of the world, as it were. Common and cheap. So much so, people will have it engraved on their bodies, tattooed. You have it on their symbol, on their ornaments. So much so, a Hollywood actor, I think, recently made even a picture on the titled Passion. And a lot of Adventists have gone and seen that movie. Historically, the cross. Historically, the cross is never an emblem of dignity. It was never sacred. It was an invention of a pagan mind, the mind of a Roman, a barbaric symbol, a symbol of pain and suffering and death. It was cruel. It was a business of a cruel thing, barbaric in its nature. Spartacus, that soldier, turned to be a soldier when he revolted. The Roman government, virtually thousands of them, were nailed to the crosses and hung on the roads of Rome. It was nothing to be proud of. People broke their legs because they couldn't have any support. They will die faster because it would take them 1 week to 10 days to 2 weeks to die on the cross. People came out on the roads as a citizenry. Citizens came out and mocked at those people who are hanging on the cross. It was not anything but shameful. It is a cruel business. When people are flogged, they die. But they are put up on the cross. That's what precisely happened to Jesus Christ. And I have taken this text as a key text of thought For the Jew requests a sign and the Greek seeks after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified. We preach Christ crucified. Virtually, Daniel saw this kingdom coming up. And he says, after this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, exceedingly strong. It had huge iron teeth. The iron monarchy of Roman kingdom virtually nailed Jesus Christ to the cross. Who determined such a death for Jesus Christ? Who determined such a cruel death on the cross for the Son of God? Was it the Roman? Was it the Jew? Was it you and me? Who determined such a death for the Son of God, who created the heavens and the earth? This is why it says on Patriarchs and Prophets, page 63, since the divine law is as sacred as God himself, only one equal with God could make atonement for its transgression. None but Christ could redeem fallen man from the curse of the law and bring him again into harmony with heaven. Christ would take upon himself the guilt and shame of sin. Sin so offensive to a holy God that it must separate the Father and his Son. Christ would reach to the depths of misery to rescue the ruined race. Who determined it? It's, as we say in the corporate environment, a corporation derives its existence out of the contemplation of the law. Cross originated in the contemplation of the divine counsel. Adam, where art thou? The call of God resulted in the implementation of the plan of redemption, which was conceived in the mind and counsels of God. The lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world, an innocent lamb representing the Redeemer Savior, was sacrificed to clothe Adam and Eve. Adam to Abraham, a never-ending saga of reminder. Righteous Abel, Adam, righteous Abel, up to Noah, up to Abraham. They had to sacrifice, endure the agony of the little lamb. And it is said 930 years Adam knew that he was the cause. Even if a leaf falling to the ground pained his heart, what sin could do. After Abraham was called out, God told him, 430 years, your children will be slaves, but I'll bring them out with a mighty hand. And Moses was called 1500 BC around. And he was virtually, solely given the opportunity to look into the plan of salvation that God made for man. Moses was given the commandment, make me a sanctuary, and let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them according to all that I show you, that is the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all its furnishings, just so you shall make it. God made the plan of salvation virtually visible to the children of Israel. Testimonies to Ministers and Gospel Workers, page 123. The whole worship of the ancient Israel was a promise in figures and symbols of Christ, and was not merely a promise but an actual provision designed by God to aid millions of people by lifting their thoughts to him who was to manifest himself to our world. At the center of the social life, at the center of the economic life, at the center of their religious life, cross. Christ, the Redeemer Savior, was there. They couldn't think of anything else except a soon coming Redeemer. Adam died, Abraham died, Moses died. They all looked forward in faith while they offered the lamb as required by God. They looked forward in faith for that Redeemer. They couldn't endure the pain and the suffering of sin. They longed for that day when the Redeemer would come. I just found it on the internet somewhere. My wife helped me to find it. The sanctuary in the form of the cross. The sanctuary in the form of the cross. The holy place and the most holy. And Moses was told, there is no question of infallibility. Provision is made for a priest. Provision is made for the congregation. Provision is made for the rulers. Provision is made for the commoners. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. There is a provision for the priest. There is a provision for the congregation. There is a provision for the ruler and a commoner. All through the blood of a slain animal. And almost all things are by the law purged with blood. And without shedding of the blood, there is no remission of sin. And that is the reason why we are told to look forward to the Lamb of God. The Day of Atonement. Yom Kippur, as the Jewish people would call it. Leviticus 16th chapter beautifully illustrates. The high priest once a year had to enter into the most holy place with a blood of a bull for himself. There is no infallibility of a priesthood. Priests sin, rulers sin, church sins, members sin, everybody sins. Unfortunately, today the church says infallibility. Church cannot sin. Whereas God, olden times itself, had made a provision for everyone. Because everybody sins. Unfortunately, 2,000 years virtually, they are acquainted with this service of sacrifice. But when the Redeemer came, did they receive him? They should have been the first ones to receive. John 1:11, he came to his own, and his own did not receive him. Isaiah 53:3, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Whole chapter 53, first 12 verses, you can read. Beautiful presentation of the Lamb of God. The big question is, would we do the same? The children of God, the children of Israelite, for 2,000 years they have been trained through the offerings, to the economic system that they were given by God himself. 1,500 years after the slavery, everybody was looking forward for a Redeemer. And when he came, did they receive him? Yes. In our key text, we have three groups of people. The Jews, the Greeks, the third, the called. The called from among both the Jews and the Gentiles. For the Jew, Jesus Christ is a stumbling block. For the Greek, it is all foolishness because he is highly educated. He is a reasoned man. For the Jew who has been anticipating the Lamb of God, it is a stumbling block. Because he did not fit. But amongst them, God has a group called the called of God. Modern identity of these three groups. This is my reasoning. The Jew then is the church today. The Jew then is the church today. Jews knew everything about Christ. He was in everything, in their social life, economic life, religious life. Yet when he came, they did not want to know him. It is a purpose-driven action. John 1:29 to 30. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Behold the Lamb of God." The children of Israel were not simply thrust upon by Jesus Christ. There is an Elijah standing in front of them. "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world." But they did not want to. He is a stumbling block. Today's Christianity glories in the fact that Jesus died on the cross. We all glory in that fact. Like the Jews gloried in their socio-economic system, which portrayed a redeemer who would come and set them at the top of the world economy. They would be the conquerors. They would be the rulers of the world. But that is never God's purpose in sending his son to this world. He was to be a substitute for man. He was to pay the debt by his life. Romans 3:23. "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace and through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood through faith to demonstrate his righteousness," not our righteousness. 1 John 2:2, "And he himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. But when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive adoption as sons and daughters." Unfortunately, Christendom stops there. Unfortunately, Christianity stops there. The crucified Christ, the risen Christ, had become a stumbling block to the rest of the Christian world. How? We don't need to keep the Ten Commandments anymore. God nailed them to the cross. There is no judgment. People go to heaven right after they die, or they go to hell right after they die. There can't be a temple in the heaven. Whole heaven is the temple. Or they all preach like we are all hearing nowadays, end of the world. 2012. I suppose Brother Roland was talking about the other man. what is his name? Harold Camping. He's saying only 2-3 more months, right? 2-3 more months, according to him. The unique SDA doctrine: it is not enough Jesus died on the cross. Mark my words. It is not enough that Jesus Christ died on the cross. He was only a sacrificial lamb of God on the cross. He has a priestly work. He is my high priest. He has a job to do in the sanctuary that God made with his own hands. And he must accomplish that job as a high priest. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me." That's Mary, crying there. And when Mary found him, "Did you take my Lord somewhere and hide him?" Please tell me where you hid him. I will take him and go. And then the Lord in his pity said, Mary. And she recognized his voice. And she must have fallen at his feet, not to let him go. But Jesus said, do not cling to me. King James Version puts it, do not touch me. For I have not ascended to my Father. Why so? Why so? In the same evening, when he came down and the disciples were hiding in a room because of the fear of the Jews, he received their adoration. He received their worship. But to Mary, he says, do not touch me. For I have a job to do. I have to know from my Father whether he accepts my sacrifice on behalf of man or not. He refused the adoration of the angels. He refused the worship of men until he knew that his Father accepted his sacrifice on your behalf and on my behalf. He had to go to the heavenly sanctuary to be seated on the right hand. For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats could take away sins. Therefore, when he came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for me. Now this is the main point of the things we are saying. We have such a high priest who is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle which the Lord erected and not man. I have not brought up everything else that I have been thinking about, but still I have brought enough. Still bearing humanity, she writes in Signs of the Times, April 15, 1905, still bearing humanity, he ascended to heaven, triumphant and victorious. He has taken the blood of the atonement into the holiest of all, sprinkled it upon the mercy seat and his own garment, and blessed the people. Soon he will appear the second time to declare that there is no more sacrifice for sin. Jesus had to go to the heavenly sanctuary as yours and mine high priest. October 22, 1844, we call it great disappointment, but I call it a blessing, a blessing. And he said to me, for 2,300 days when the sanctuary shall be cleansed. Today, the Seventh-day Adventist Church benefits from this great disappointment because it provoked our pioneer to study the scriptures, particularly the books of Daniel and Revelation, in conjunction with the books of Leviticus and Hebrews. The gift of the spirit of prophecy. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Explicitly, the church was blessed through the ministry of Sister White, who was granted visions of the great controversy, for which she had dedicated no less than 11 chapters in the book by the same title, Great Controversy. Go home and verify those books. Go home and check up those chapters. The intercession of Christ in man's behalf in the sanctuary above is as essential to the plan of salvation as was his death upon the cross. My brothers and sisters, Seventh-day Adventist Church, wake up. By his death, he began that work which after his resurrection, he ascended to complete in heaven. We must by faith enter with him within the veil, whither the forerunner is for us entered. Solemn are the scenes connected with the closing work of the atonement. Momentous are the interests involved therein. The judgment is now passing in the sanctuary above. For many years this work has been in progress. Soon, none know how soon, it will pass to the cases of the living. You do not know when my name will come up. I do not know when my name will come up. I do not know when my wife's name will come up. But soon it will come up. That is the doctrine of the uniqueness of Seventh-day Adventist Church. Investigative judgment. There is a judgment going right now because Jesus died on the cross for me and for my sins. My Savior, my Redeemer, and my priest. My God, what has happened to the Seventh-day Adventist Church today. To the Greek, it is foolishness, because we have become educated, highly qualified people. The Greek of the modern day is a Christian who claims to know Jesus but stops at the cross. For him, it is foolishness that there is a judgment going on now in heaven. You talk to anybody on the road, he will say, "Are you sure that there is a judgment?" Because he believes he goes to heaven at death. The judgment must begin at the house of God. But the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel? Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, "Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come. And worship him who made the heaven, earth, and sea, and the springs of the waters." What is the basis of the judgment? The books of record in heaven, in which the names and the deeds of men are registered, are to determine the decisions of the judgment. Says the prophet Daniel, the judgment was set and the books were opened. Great Controversy, page 480. I'm not reading everything. The books. The book of life contains the names of all who ever entered the service of God, whoever baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. The book of remembrance is written before God, in which are recorded the good deeds of them that fear the Lord and that thought upon his name. Their words of faith, their acts of love are registered in heaven. There every temptation resisted is recorded. Every evil overcome, it is recorded. Every word of tender pity that we showed is recorded, is faithfully chronicled. And every act of sacrifice, every suffering and sorrow endured for Christ's sake is recorded. That is the book of remembrance. What about my bad? For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. Every idle word that man shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment, says the Savior. By thy words thou shalt be judged, justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. Ecclesiastes and Matthew. The question is, who can escape? Who can escape such a scrutiny? While the investigative judgment is going forward in heaven, while the sins of pertinent believers are being removed from the sanctuary, that's where the great disappointment took place. Cleansing of the sanctuary, they thought that it is going to be the earth. There is to be a special work of purification, of putting away of sin among God's people upon the earth. This work is more clearly presented in the messages of the three angels. When this work shall have been accomplished, the work that is going on right now in the heavenly sanctuary, Jesus Christ moved into the most holy place, 1844, October 22nd. When this work shall have been accomplished, the followers of Christ will be ready for his appearing. This message is now a stumbling block to the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Unfortunately, we have graduated, we have amalgamated ourselves with the Greek. And we found a lot of knowledge out there. When this work shall have been accomplished, the followers of Christ will be ready for his appearing. When that work is finished, then Jesus shall come. When this work shall have been accomplished, the followers of Christ will be ready for his appearing. Somebody might say it is impossible. I have heard it preached even in Seventh-day Adventist churches, big churches, big men. Often it is preached by many in the modern Adventist church that we can never be perfect. I must say, this is J.S. Paul talking, I must say they don't understand what is the meaning of the cleansing of the sanctuary. Putting away the sin, cleaning the heavenly sanctuary from the sins of those who follow Jesus Christ. Everyone who is truly waiting for the Lord's return has a job to do. Great controversy, page 488. The subject of the sanctuary and the investigative judgment should be clearly understood by the people of God. All need a knowledge for themselves of the position and the work of their great high priest. What is Jesus doing? We must know it. How shall we know it? Ask and it shall be given to you. Not what I want, but the Holy Spirit. Ask for the Holy Spirit. Bow down before him. Go on your knees and beg him, reveal to me. And God shall reveal the truth. It will be impossible for them to exercise the faith if we don't understand, which is essential at this time, are to occupy the position which God designs them to fill. Every individual has a soul to save or to lose. Each has a case pending at the bar of God. Each must meet the great judge face to face. How important then that every mind contemplate upon the solemn scene when the judgment shall sit and the book shall be opened, when with Daniel every individual must stand in his lot at the end of the days. Do we realize the seriousness of the times that we are living in, my brothers and sisters? Jesus Christ waited for the thief. Jesus said, I lay down my life and I take it back. Nobody puts me to death, nobody makes me up. Except the angel appeared on the third night, Sunday early morning, and said to Jesus, called out to Jesus, Son of God, thy Father calleth thee. Son of God, thy Father calleth thee. And Jesus Christ comes forth, busting the grave itself. Such a God waited for the thief to repent and say, remember me, Lord, when thou comest in the cloud. Jesus could have died, but he waited, knowing that thief was willing to give his life to him. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but he is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to, and I am included. Which group we will be in? The Jew are the modern day church. The Greek are the intellectual, the sophisticated, the theologian, intellectual reasoning. Or would you be rather call of God? We are call of God, aren't we? He shall come. He will not tarry. When he comes with a reward. My reward is with me to give to every man according to his deeds. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. Jesus is coming soon. The question is, am I ready? Not he died on the cross, it's history. But what matters is what he is doing on your behalf and on my behalf in the sanctuary above. There should never remain a sin that is unconfessed. There should never remain a sin that should keep us away from the kingdom of God. Lord Jesus, come soon. May the church be ready when he comes.